Lecture 10. The theme is the state system of the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland. Now today we are going to discuss the third question, that is separation of powers under the British Constitution. The conception of the separation of powers has been applied to the United Kingdom under the nature of its executive, judicial and legislative functions. Historically, the apparent merger of the executive and the legislature with a powerful prime minister drawn from the largest party in parliament and usually with a safe majority led theorists to contend that the separation of powers is not applicable to the United Kingdom. However, in recent years it does seem to have been adopted as a necessary part of the United Kingdom Constitution. The independence of the judiciary has never been questioned as a principle, although application is problematic. Personnel have been increasingly isolated from the other organs of government, no longer sitting in the House of Lords or in the Cabinet. The court's ability to legislate through precedent, its inability to question validly enacted law through legislative supremacy and parliamentary sovereignty. The separation of powers has come under the stress of increasing government intervention into social issues outside its former remit, dominated by administration and the foreign and the military policy. The creation of big government. This has been seen by some as having led to a weakening of the concept of government replaced with the concept of governance. This lends itself to a more flexible approach considering the wide variation in the sorts of things that the executive does. A similar approach is to take an approach of public choice theory. The self-interest of political actors and under this theory bridges the separate sections of government drawing upon the approach of the Committee on Standards in Public Life, which applies the same rules to different organs, although their approach to judges is separate. Either theory would accept that there are wider decision-making processes which are not restricted to a single branch of government. Another important idea is that variations within each separate part of government are as significant as differences in approach between branches and require similar consideration. The executive comprises of official and public authorities, including local authorities, that govern the United Kingdom, from initiating and implementing legislation to the running of local and national services, such as rubbish collections and the police. The civil service remains non-partisan. The executive also exercises a number of powers under the royal prerogative, including foreign relations. Many other actions are taken in the sovereign's name, from whom executive power is derived. The Council and the Commission of the European Union also exercise executive power, as do devolved governments. Within the executive, there is no longer a clear elected, non-elected divide. Decision makers are of both sorts since the widening of the government's remit. The extent to which the civil service serves the government rather than usurping it is one character of the executive. The judicial function determines the outcome of disputes and performs minor legislative and administrative functions. It oversees both public and private law through civil and criminal courts and a variety of tribunals. The Human Rights Act 1998 has placed a requirement that courts take into account the jurisprudence of the European Court of Human Rights. The introduction of a tax is a legislative function. Collecting tax is an executive and administrative function. Settling tax disputes is a judicial function, as is judicial review of executive decisions. However, such an approach does not in itself enlighten what each role entails. The audit of public expenditure was a judicial function in the 14th century, an executive one in the 18th, and is now a legislative function. This is not in itself a measure of efficiency or good process, or what the function actually entails. The separation of powers may require, depending on interpretation, that the membership of the three powers must be separate, that one of the three powers does not control the work of another, or that one organ of government should not exercise the powers of another. Keeping all three roles separate is seen as both theoretically and practically impossible.